Good evening, good afternoon. My name is Ashok Gurung. I'm the Senior Director of India-China Institute, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you all to this conference titled The Environment in India and China, Histories and Innovations. I would like to extend a special note of appreciation for all those who have traveled from outside of New York to join us. Some of you had to travel all the way from India and China, so we really appreciate it very much. It is really good to see many old friends and a few new friends who are here today. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to first thank a couple of people and organizations within the new school who have been sponsoring this event and say a few words about the conference. And then I'm going to invite my friend and colleague and also a boss, Ron Casimir, to give welcome remarks on behalf of the university. So first thing I want to do is really thank Star Foundation for not only establishing India-China Institute, but also generously supporting our activities, including this conference. I don't see Paula Lawrence, Vice President of Star Foundation, for her steadfast support. And also Toby Volkman, she should be here any minute. Toby was the Deputy Provost at the New School who helped establish India-China Institute, and now a director at Luce Foundation, and she's also supporting a project, a multi-year project at the New School right now. Well, in brief, we currently have 6 India-China Institute fellows. 5 of them are here. You will get to know them in the course of today and tomorrow. One fellow could not join us here for family reasons. But overall, what I want to say about these India-China Institute fellows is we have had exceptional, very collegial, and productive 2.5 years of deliberations on the theme of social innovation for sustainable environments. I want to thank our fellows for their dedication and hard work. Today, I also want to thank co-sponsors for this conference, Environmental Studies Program, John Clinton, somewhere here, right? Global Studies Program, and Julian Studley, Global Program for International Affairs. Well, as you know, whenever you're organizing an event like this, many, many people work behind the scenes, so this was no exception. I want to particularly acknowledge and thank Chris Cruz. Where is Chris? Somewhere here. Chris is the coordinator of this conference. Grace Ho, India-China Institute office manager, and many research assistants. Most of them are graduate students and undergraduate students at the New School. Sophia, Shalini, Tyler, Bridget, Peter, Dhana, Sophia, and many others who have really helped convene this conference. This conference is really partly a celebration and partly a culmination of 2 years, 2.5 years of efforts by the fellows. So here I want to thank India-China Institute fellows really for helping to conceptualize the conference and hosting it with us today. As you will note in your program agenda, we are very fortunate and very pleased to convene a very highly respected group of scholars and experts who will help us critically review and explore important linkages surrounding ecology, history, and innovations surrounding environment, and especially focused on India and China. Knowing a bit about their work, I can assure you that we will learn a great deal from our deliberations today and tomorrow. So for that, I want to thank all the distinguished presenters, chairs, and discussants for participating in this conference. At ICI, India-China Institute, and very much in the tradition of the new school, we believe moments like this allow us to focus on not just coming up with solutions or answers, but really continue the process of, you know, really asking hard questions, review debates in a critical manner. So for that reason, as well as in that spirit, we hope these next, you know, 2 days will, you know, give us another, you know, opportunity to advance our own thinking, assumptions, and hopefully, you know, ways to grapple with complex issues surrounding the topic that we are going to discuss. Let me also take this opportunity to again, you know, acknowledge that India-China Institute is at a very important crossroads, especially, you know, as some of you know, we recently appointed and welcomed two very, you know, respected academics to the Institute as India-China Institute academic co-directors. So I want to again, you know, point out Professor Sanjay Reddy and Professor Mark Fraser, you know, who is going to chair this session. They they will be with us for the next, you know, 2 days, and you will be seeing them as we develop, you know, the work of India-China Institute in hopefully much more interesting and exciting ways. So again, thank you all. And now what I would like to do is invite Ron Casimir, who will welcome you all on behalf of the university.
Well, thank you. And I want to reiterate Ashok's welcome. It is great to have you here at the New School, whether you are new schoolers, people from nearby or from afar, welcome. And thanks for taking part in what I think is going to be a really important event. It's a pleasure to have you all here. Ashok has done almost all of the thank yous, and I don't want to take up time repeating them, though I do want to quickly again acknowledge our supporters and partners at the Star Foundation for making this possible, for other programs at the New School who've helped in the planning and organization of this. Ashok mentioned them. And obviously all of you. I especially want to reiterate thanking Ashok and his team for putting together, along with the fellows of the current crop of fellows for the India-China program, of putting together such an amazing program as you have here for the next 2 days. Grace, Chris, and others, it's always remarkable for us folks here at the New School at how EC manages to put together these events, attract crowds around topics of great interest, and Ashok and his group deserve a lot of credit. So thank you guys. I just want to give a little bit of background, and I know you're anxious to get to the meat of this conference. As Ashok mentioned, the conference is built largely around this theme of social innovation and sustainable environments, which was the theme of the third phase of EC's fellowship program. And the New School is very proud of EC's accomplishments, and it's continuing to grow under Ashok's leadership, and now, as Ashok mentioned, our two new faculty directors, Mark Fraser and Sanjay Reddy, and of course a larger group of faculty and students who are deeply involved in the life of the institution, of the Institute. It's interesting because a major goal of the New School as it's evolved in the last years has been to bring together, both for collaboration and for debate, the diverse perspectives of design and of the social sciences in order both to push the frontiers of knowledge, but also to connect that knowledge to practical action for the public good. And EC, especially in this program, the Social Innovation and Sustainable Environments, has really been at the forefront of this intersection. I think through bringing in different faculty and students from different parts of the university, EC has really been one of the places at the new school where the connections between design and social science have been made in a deep and, I think, sustainable way. And I think this conference is an important example and result of that commitment. So as Ashok mentioned, the current cohort of fellows who are from India, from China, and faculty of the new school are tasked with generating new ideas, approaches, solutions to social innovation and for sustainable environments in world's two most populous and arguably most dynamic countries. And today's event provides a unique opportunity to feature their work alongside that of other experts and actors. And in doing so, this conference should help shape the final results of their projects and the impact that work will have. So this conference is both an important event in and of itself, but also will have lasting impact on the work of the EC fellows and hopefully others who are here today. So I don't want to delay you any longer from the proceedings. Again, thanks so much for coming and contributing to this event. I look forward to I can only stay for part of this first panel, but I know it's going to be a rich couple of days and look forward to hearing about it. So thanks again.
Thank you. Well, welcome everyone to the first panel entitled Ecology. I am Mark Fraser, as the two previous speakers have pointed out. I'm very honored to be chairing a panel of this type with leading figures in the field of ecology, of sustainable environments and innovation, the theme of this conference. I wanted to say that I'm particularly impressed and looking forward to this and all the other panels to hearing about concepts like environment, ecosystem, ecology, and to the extent to which these can be de-Americanized or de-Westernized, taken out of the American or Western-centric notions and reference to which they may perhaps be derived, and to be placed in a proper or more accurate or more clear context, cultural and historical context, as relates to Chinese history and culture and Indian history and culture. A few brief words about the way this panel will be set up. Each panelist will talk for 20 minutes, and there'll be a timekeeper here at the front if you need to glance down and see where things stand. Ali will let you know. Those three presentations will be followed by discussants, each providing 10 minutes of remarks on the panelists' presentations. And I will now introduce the panelists, and then upon completion of their presentations, I'll introduce our distinguished discussants. We will hear first from Kamaljit Bawa, who is a distinguished professor of biology at the University of Massachusetts, Boston, and founder and president of the Bangalore-based Ashoka Trust for Research in Ecology and the Environment. All of his bio and all the other participants' bios are provided in the program, and I direct your attention to those for further information. Next, we will hear from Stuart Pickett, who is an ecologist at the Carey Institute of Ecosystem Studies here in New York. And third, we will hear from Professor Liu Zhi, who is professor of conservation biology at Peking University and the executive director of the Center for Nature and Society at Peking University. The first presenter, Professor Bawa, paper or presentation is entitled China, India, and the Environment. Professor Pickett will then present on meaning, model, and metaphor in ecological science as tools for integrating, interacting with innovators. And then Professor Liu will present a talk entitled Integrating Science and Traditional Culture into Conservation Policies on the Tibetan Plateau. Thank you, Professor Pao.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm delighted to be here. And I'm really very grateful to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to share our work with you. And I believe the clock starts ticking now, maybe 19 minutes and 30 seconds. I think I'm going to stick to the theme that the organizers had given us, and that is change. The world is changing. In a very profound way, and there are consequences of these changes, and what type of new knowledge we need to meet the challenges, societal challenges, that are arising out of these changes. And I'm going to talk about the Himalaya, because the Himalaya is the region which is shared by China and India. And I also want to stick to that theme, India, China, and the environment together. What you're looking at is North Sikkim on the side of India. Behind these mountains is China. I'm not used to PCs. My talk is based on a paper I published 2 years ago on China, India, and the environment. And the paper did receive quite a bit of attention. It was immediately followed by a symposium organized by American Association for the Advancement of Science, where they invited people from India and China to talk about some of the issues. But the activities, I think, fizzled out quickly after that. And it's really my sincere hope that the India-China Institute can get interested in some of the issues I'm going to be talking about, and we can pursue some new avenues of work. I'm not used to, okay, I said that before. Himalaya, why is it important? Several reasons. It's a hot spot of biodiversity, and the biodiversity in the Himalayas is incredible. You will be looking at different species of primulas during the next 15, 20 seconds. There are about 400 species of primulas in the Himalayas. It's a center of origin and evolution and diversification of the primroses. It's one of the biodiversity hotspots. About 400 species of rhododendrons, 300 on the Chinese side and perhaps 100 on the Indian side. Incredible diversity of life. Just want to give you a moment to enjoy these things so that my voice doesn't interfere. The beautiful sunbirds that pollinate many of these rhododendrons. And of course, this biological diversity is intertwined with tremendous cultural and ethnic diversity in the region. More than 200 languages, more than 200 ethnic groups. And of course, this diversity sustains the livelihoods of millions of people. All this was, of course, a shameless plug for my new book coming out next month. I will be taking advanced orders after the talk. Himalaya is very important from the point of view of climate change. It has been called the water tower of Asia. Asia's eight largest cities, largest rivers, originate in the Himalayas. Collectively, the basins of these rivers have more than 1.3 billion people living there. So what happens in Himalayas affects one quarter of humanity. There is climate change underway. Himalaya is also called the third pole because the amount of ice locked in the Himalaya is second only to the ice in the poles. Climate change is underway, but we have very little knowledge about the extent and magnitude of this climate change. You go to Google, look for climate change in the Himalaya, you will get quite a few papers on glaciers, but after that, the impact of climate change or the extent and magnitude of climate change, you will not get much information. A colleague of mine, a graduate student of mine, Uttam Acharasta, and I looked at some records. And this is a very complicated data set. It took us 2 years to do this work, which has resulted in this one graph. And there are a couple of more graphs I will show you. But it's taken a lot of analysis, and I will not bore you with details. What you see in different colors are the different ecoregions of the Himalayas, from the west to the east. There are 13 ecoregions. For each ecoregion, we try to document change in temperature, precipitation, and other parameters one by one, and then we average these figures. So during those 25-year periods from 1982 to 2006, the temperature in Himalaya has changed by 1.5 degrees centigrade. Himalaya has become warmer by 1.5 degrees centigrade, which is three times more than the global average and which is much more than what is predicted by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. The precipitation in the Himalaya has increased by 165 millimeters. People in the region comment that the rainfall has become erratic, and there are different definitions of what is meant by erratic, and we are analyzing some of those data. Another change is underway. Hydropower projects in the Himalayas, both on the Indian side and on the Chinese side. What you're looking is a riverbed. In remote corners of North Sikkim, where a series of dams are being built in River Tista, that's not the only river, but this photograph is from that river in North Sikkim. Not a very long river, perhaps 50, 60 kilometers, or maybe a little bit more. 22 dams are going to be built on that river. You may not be able to read this table. India currently generates about 15,000 megawatts of energy from hydropower plants in the Himalayas. The plans during the next 20 years is to generate 126,000 megawatts of energy from the hydropower projects. Bhutan currently generates about 1,500 megawatts of energy. And the plans are to generate about 17,000 megawatts of energy, proportionately much more than in India. And you go down Nepal, the same situation. 400 hydropower projects are going to be built during the next 20 years on the Indian side of the Himalaya, and 400 projects on the Chinese side. The region, very unstable geologically, and from a seismic point of view, will have the highest concentration of dams anywhere in the world. So there is change. I've just given you a few examples. I haven't talked about land use change. Apart from climate change, we have done quite a bit of work on land use change. There is development infrastructure in terms of hydropower, population growth. Nobody talks about the border conflict between China and India. Major source of degradation. I can't show you the pictures because people will ask, how did I take these pictures of military installations and all that movement on the highways and so on and so forth? All these changes have a disproportionate impact on poor. And I just want to leave you with that thought. It's the poor who suffer most from all these changes we are talking about. And we have a huge program in terms of working with the local rural communities, how we can help them cope with the change, but I will not go into the details. And I just want to move on to the next point. We were asked to talk about knowledge, innovative knowledge. For me, to some extent, when you generate knowledge, you are dealing with innovation. You are doing new things. And I like to talk about knowledge in the sense of usable knowledge. We need usable knowledge to confront the challenges we are facing. What is usable knowledge? Scholars have characterize three features of usable knowledge. It should be relevant, it should be credible, and it should be salient. And I think we have a deficit of usable knowledge. We have a lot of knowledge in the world, and a lot of knowledge is being generated. But there is not enough of usable knowledge that is being generated. And the major constraints in generation of usable knowledge is the institutions. We lack the type of institutions that can generate the type of knowledge or usable knowledge we need, especially in developing countries, and especially, I should mention, China and India. And there should be no reason for that, because both countries have huge resources, and both countries are making very large investments in higher education and setting up all sorts of institutions. And then, secondly, I think we have not looked seriously at the ways we produce knowledge. And I think that's the second challenge we face. Here is another plug. And I want to share with you some experiences at the Ashoka Trust for Research in Ecology and the institution. The organization that I founded in 96 in India. And I don't know what overcame me that I was left with about $15,000 from a grant, and that I thought I could set up an institute with $15,000. Crazy idea. I must be crazy. I was crazy at that time. but I did it. Today, the institution has 22 full-fledged fellows, 22 faculty members, other support staff, a total staff of 160 people. We are active in two areas, Himalayas and in the Western Ghats. And you're looking at our new building, which was completed almost 2 years ago. It's a new green building. And our budget is currently about $2 million. All the 22 fellows are supported by endowments. A University of Pennsylvania study recently ranked major environmental research centers and think tanks throughout the world. And we were ranked number 19th globally and number one in Asia. And I tell you why. This is how we are organized. We have two centers, and these are virtual, three centers, I should say, okay, two centers, virtual centers. Under each center, and I won't repeat what is on the slide, you can read those, we have two programs under each center. The main thing is that these centers are interdisciplinary. The programs are interdisciplinary. Natural scientists and social scientists and historians, sociologists, they are organized into teams to address the major challenges we face. The organization might look very different 10 years from now. 10 years from now, we might be working on very different themes, and we might be differently organized so that we remain dynamic. And then we have Academy for Conservation Science and Sustainability Studies that anchors our academic program. And the centerpiece of that academic program is a new doctoral program, again interdisciplinary, in conservation science and sustainability studies. Let me address the second point, production of knowledge. So I covered the institution, and we can discuss again at length institution. India-China school or center here is a new type of institution that proposes to do things very differently. So there was not enough knowledge about climate change in the Himalaya. And we thought, you know, people must have a lot of knowledge about climate change. They have to deal with climate change. So we did one of the largest household surveys I think ever conducted on this particular topic. We did an ethnographic survey of about 500 households. And what we found was that people have tremendous reservoir of knowledge about climate change. These different color bars represent different villages. On the vertical axis are the percentages of people, you know, up to 100%, for example, in the first category, in some villages, people believe that it is warming. And then similarly, very large number of people believe that early summer is being set, there is early monsoon, there is increased snow melting, dying of water, and so on and so forth. And there's a great deal of consistency among villagers in responses. Biological effects, early flowering, rain shift of species, appearance of mosquitoes, new crop pests, new weeds, and science is telling us the same thing. So there is a great deal of consistency between what the scientists are saying and what the people are saying. And I know I have 1 minute. Over? 1 minute, all right. And again, I'm not going to read that. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to combine this traditional ecological knowledge with modern knowledge, bring various stakeholders together to address the issue of climate change in the Himalayas. That's one of our programs. And so we have a very complicated scenario here. But the key thing is, in each step, it is a participatory process. It's people coming together and discussing what type of knowledge we have, what is likely to happen, what type of scenarios are possible, and then how we can cope with climate change. This is my last slide. Okay, not last slide, but I'm almost there. So if you want sustainable landscapes that are resilient to change, the call for livelihood security and social equity, we need integration of knowledge. Integration of knowledge across disciplines, knowledge systems, and geographical scales. And for that, we need new institutions for generating usable knowledge and for linking action research with policies and governance. And I think this is clearly they want me off because the last slide was the sun. Is this? Okay. I thought it was sabotage that I was not getting off the stage.
We wouldn't do that.
Of course not. I don't know why it's not showing. That's why I never use PC. Okay. There was a picture of a farmer here. So as the first rays of sun hit Kanchenjunga, and the first sunbird comes out for its meal in the morning, and the farmer rises to ponder over how he or she is going to deal with the climate change, I think we have unprecedented opportunities to generate knowledge in ways we have never thought before. Thank you very much.
Do you want to speak from the podium or the table? Either way, yeah. Okay.
All right. I figure that with 20 minutes, I can say three things, which is probably two too many. Well, we've heard a really good example, many good examples, of how the world is changing, and some thoughts and examples about the institutional changes that might be useful in responding to and preparing for, adapting to those changes. And I want to talk about how ecology might be a partner with innovators who are concerned about those kinds of things. My assumption is that I'm talking to a room that is not full of ecologists, with a couple of exceptions. How many people have had a course in ecology? Not bad. How many people have had five courses in ecology? All right, we got some partisans here. But what I want to do is just give you a little bit of sense of how ecology has changed. So there are three points. One is that ecology is responding to an evolving urban context globally, which is something new for ecology. The second thing that I want to do is to talk about three ways that we might think about linking between ecology and innovators in other disciplines or other practices. And I'm going to highlight meaning in the sense of definition, model and metaphor. And then I'm going to close with a few comments about something that I'm extremely excited about that I'm exploring with some of my architect colleagues and landscape architect colleagues at Parsons, the Metacity. The evolving context, you want this closer. The evolving context is really appropriate to think about in the India-China Institute because India and China are really exemplars of the vast kinds of changes that we are experiencing in the world today. We all have to deal in our disciplines or in our professions with increasingly globalized processes. Climate change, you've heard about some really nice examples from Professor Bawa. And another thing that we are seeing globally is the emergence of entirely new relationships between what traditionally we have called urban and rural. One of the things that I've been studying for the last 20 years is urban ecology, which is something that in North America has been difficult to do because of the biases. This is about the most anti-urban country on the planet. Maybe Canada's pretty close to that. But we don't like cities much in the United States. And it's part of our national philosophy to value wilderness and to value the family farm, which is something that hardly exists anymore, but still those are the ideals that we hold. And another thing that global processes point to thinking about urbanization is entirely new ways to put cities together, entirely new reasons to be in cities, and interesting new mixes of what cities are for. Another part of our evolving context in the global north, or the, I always get into trouble with these words, the global north, or the formerly colonially empowered countries, or the industrial sinks, is a post-industrial crisis. Europe, the United States, in many places experience shrinking cities. We experience people fleeing the formerly industrial city cores. But a part of this evolving context is a recognition by municipal leaders, leaders in various regions and sometimes nations, that we need to work toward increasing sustainability so that many municipalities, many regions are developing sustainability plans. And that is a part, a hopeful part of our evolving context. So that's the first point, that ecology as a partner is aware of this evolving context and in many ways is working to play in that changing arena. So now, to link with ecology, here are some things that I want to make you aware of, those of you who haven't had the 1 or 5 courses in ecology. Ecology is a science. You saw some really nice examples of data from Professor Bawa. Ecology deals with data, expectations about how the world works. Back in the old days, we said expectations about how the natural world works. Well, now it's expectations about how that mix of natural, that hybrid between natural and built and used environments, how that environment works. What are the expectations? And then we put into place observations, experiments, models, and long-term studies to figure out whether our expectations are right or not. And if they're not right, why are they wrong? Now, to do this, we use conceptual constructs, or concepts, if you will, theory, if you will. That's what specifies what our expectations are. And each environmental concept and all of our theories have embedded in them 3 dimensions. And one of the reasons that I point this out is that when we talk across disciplinary boundaries and when we talk with people who are engaged in action about ecology, we'll use words, I will use words, my pointy-headed academic colleagues will use words in very specific ways, if we're being careful. And often, will be misconstrued because our terms and our concepts have these 3 definitions, these 3 dimensions, these 3 aspects. Meaning, that is the definition, the core idea. What's an example of that? Ecosystem. One of the simplest ideas in ecology, that organisms and environment and specified volumes of the earth interact with each other and transform energy and matter and information in the course of that interaction. That's it. That's an ecosystem. It can be big, it can be small, it can be self-supporting, or it can exploit resources from outside. That's it. Often, however, when the word ecosystem or any number of our other terms are used, it's the metaphor that stands out. And ecosystem, that basic idea that we can measure, we can apply everywhere, whether it's in the deep sea or the Himalaya or New York City, this thing is not fixed by scale, and it doesn't assume anything about good or bad. The metaphors, as when the ecosystem is used as a metaphor, however, people often use it to mean to represent connectivity. Yes, there are connections in ecosystems. They often use it to represent stability. Yes, some ecosystems are stable for some period of time. They use it to represent diversity. Some ecosystems are diverse, some ecosystems are simple. They use it to represent resistance to change. Some ecosystems are resistant. The ones that actually persist are the ones that adapt and adjust. So we've got these metaphors that stand in distinction to the basic concepts. Now, what's between these basic definitions and these metaphors is models. Models are the tools that we use to take the general idea, which doesn't have assumptions about say, how closed it is in the case of ecosystems or how persistent it is. And we specify what the boundaries are, what the components are, how the components are interacting over some time span that we specify in some particular spatial arena that we specify. And then we can ask on the basis of that model or those models. And they're often alternative models that apply to a situation that play out different assumptions. That's how ecologists work. That's how scientists work. And what do I know about China and India? Well, the thing, not much. And I'm really happy to be here to learn. My little Himalayan experience, because that is the borderland, is in Bhutan. And so I'm just going to tell you a story here. I've been to Bhutan twice, and some of those pictures that I saw were very reminiscent of places in Bhutan. I think, in fact, the tiger's nest was one of your pictures in Bhutan. But the first time I went to Bhutan, Thimphu was a little town, the capital city, 45,000 people. That's kind of a neighborhood here, right? 6 years later, go back to Thimphu, it's 90,000 people. 6 years. That's Asia. That's Asia. It's also Africa. It's also Africa. We've got a lot to learn from that. Well, another point that I want to make about linking with ecology is this idea that we have for metadynamics. Understanding systems as being composed of smaller, differentially connected subsystems, whether it's a community or population in particular, or landscape, and the dynamics, the degree of stability, the nature of persistence in ecological systems is often driven by the relationship between a larger system and its differentially connected subcomponents. You can call that metadynamics. Metapopulations have an explicit theory, mathematical theory in ecology. Metacommunities have an explicit mathematical theory in ecology. But that becomes a useful metaphor. Meta is all over this talk. For something else that I think is a nice tool for connecting with innovators, and that's the idea of the meta city. Which my colleague Brian McGrath, who is one of your colleagues here, introduced me to. He notes that the UN in 2007 said, well, you know, megacities don't do it anymore. Describing a big city as being 10 million people just is kind of trivial. A big city now, all right, 20 million people, that's a big city. Well, they had already used mega city, right? So they needed something else. So this next level of hugeness, they called a hyper city equals meta city. So 20 million or above, meta city. They noted that, of course, these things are so big that governance is going to be complex because you undoubtedly cross boundaries, administrative boundaries when you get that big. So that was a little bit of a functional nod. But as an ecologist who's used to thinking about metapopulations and meta-communities and meta-stability in landscapes, that word was a very, very engaging metaphor, which points me to new models of cities that go beyond just thinking about cities, that allow us to think about how city and urban are enmeshed in really new ways. And I think in both India and China have some really great examples of that sort of spatial hybridization of the urban and the rural. I mean, Asia, for example, the examples that people keep pointing to me as the best examples of urban agriculture are from Asia. So this is this combination of rural process, rural livelihood in an urban setting, for example. So metacities are beyond size. It's not about size. It is about a spatial mosaic. Wild, built, farmed, abandoned, productive, neglected, any kind of category of land that's all mixed up together. It's dynamic. It's changing. Those are not static situations. When you think about urban systems, say in the history of architecture, they're presented as these monumental things that were built to last. Well, they were built to last, but they change in spite of having been built to last. They're also open-ended. It's not a matter of saying, all right, there's a life cycle of cities. Agricultural, mercantile, industrial, post-industrial, sustainable. There's a sort of a necessary life cycle. No, it's an open-ended thing. And so often the stories about or the narratives of development tacitly assume that, and that's problematic. These things also have porous boundaries and are very, very much affected by teleconnections. My trip last summer before, to Africa presented me with some really very interesting images of couple of guys walking down the street in a little village in Tanzania, one in the Maasai robes and the herding stick, the other in the standard kind of t-shirt and sagging jeans that I can see in my neighborhood in Poughkeepsie. And the guy in the Maasai robes is on his cell phone. I mean, just the kind of connectivity that we experience now for, and sometimes used for productive purposes, sometimes used for entertainment, always, however, connecting our rural attitudes with our urban attitudes, different sorts of ways to think about life. Cities, meta-cities have hybrid elements. The elements of meta-cities, the elements of cities are hybrid. There's biology, there's physical structure in all parts of these cities. We don't necessarily always recognize the biology. It's hidden from us, or it only rears its head periodically. And the word sandy will do enough reference there. But we have an immense opportunity for innovation. The world has an immense opportunity for innovation in this new emerging meta-city environment. And ecology thinks about some of the same kinds of things that characterize the emerging meta-city. So what my big message is, simply, is that we're prepared to be part of the conversation. Global opportunities exist. Ecological science does involve metaphor, but it operates through models and it has these core concepts that translate anywhere. And the meta-city concept is something, this is a shared concept that's emerging that I think can help us interact with innovators in a variety of realms. And I think I'm done. Thank you.
Well, it's really delightful to be here and share a few thoughts. I think the agenda arranged is perfect because what I'm going to present in the next 20 minutes or 19 minutes is like a footnote to what Professor Bawa just presented, a case in a specific area. And what we try to do is exactly what Professor Pickett interpreted, explained the ecological, the ecology that within human in the system and interactions. I think ecology is all about the relationship. A little background before I start. We all know Professor Bawa well explained the importance of Himalayas and the Tibetan plateau, the value of it. So I don't have to repeat it, but a little background on what has been done on conservation in China. What we usually learn from the news, especially in this country, are bad news. The good news are seldom mentioned. So I'm here actually trying to see a few things that's different from what you often hear from the media. I'm not trying to pull out the propaganda for Chinese government. I think there are a lot of things wrong with the government, but I just want to share that's what's going on in China right now. I think there are a lot of mixed things going on, all happening in China, quite a few good things. For example, things on conservation. I think in the past 20, 30 years, the awareness on conservation has greatly increased, both from the government side and the civil society side. Give an example. The Tibetan Plateau, almost 30% of the land has set aside as protected areas. And there has been large national programs applied with billions of dollars to pay for environmental improvement, especially tree planting or grassland protection. However, there are problems with that. The protected areas, the nature reserves, tend to be very large. As you can imagine, it's a huge, vast land. And there are few staff assigned to those protected areas. So it's not nearly enough for those staff to protect the land. So most of these protected areas remain unprotected, actually. On the other hand, these national programs just applied as a cut-chopper piece for Tibetan Plateau that didn't consider the special features of this place, where especially if you look at the place, or in addition to biological features, there is a strong cultural feature that could be integrated, is a very rich asset to this area in terms of conservation, which was largely ignored. And in most cases, these conservation programs taking people as a threat to the, whether as an exploiter to natural resources or hunters or community was taken as a threat to conservation. So, but without enough capacity from the government doesn't have really have the enough capacity on the ground. So conservation is really remained as a slogan with high awareness but little impact, little effectiveness on the ground. That's the reality. So what I'm trying to, the case I'm introduce is a couple examples to show you how the things could be changed, could be improved. The first example is actually a case done by a Tibetan monk and his association in Senjiangyuan region, which I will give a little introduction later. His name is Jiaxi Sange. He's a born natural scientist and also an artist who does a lot of painting. And he rediscovered this bird, a Tibetan bunting, which was never seen again since after 1930s. And not only that, he studied this bird, its natural history, reproduction, threats, and so on. And we helped him to write up a scientific paper that will be published in a peer-reviewed journals. Here, I won't bore you to all the details, just show you that the research he has done has it's very personalized, but very also scientific observation, very detailed observation, and long time, several years, continuous, because he's interested in it. And then he thought about, when he started learned about the threats to the bird, which is very narrowly distributed, what to do? There's a conflict between the bird nesting, for example, with the grazing, because yaks tend to step on the bird nests. And this is his drawing, by the way. So to do that, he formed an association. And what's most the coolest thing is, with his painting ability, he draw a tanka on this bird. And he asked all the 23 monasteries around the bird's range area to endorse the bird as a sacred bird. So now, in his word, he says, now the bird is a Buddha, is a god. The bird can protect itself. Because people, now they print out this picture, and people would put this picture in their shrine, not the average ordinary bird anymore. So this is a kind of idea I would never imagine myself as a scientist. And we are continuously monitoring how this methodology is made effective in future, as a result, if the bird actually increased in population. The second example is a grassland. I mentioned about one size fits all national policies from top down, from the national government, which is privatization. That thinking people, is based on the theory of a common, tragedy of commons. However, this area has never had privatized the land in the past. Its land was always communally shared. The livestock belonged to the household. And because people were seen as an enemy to nature conservation. So the idea was to move them out and ban the grazing. So these are the results: fencing and concentrated settlements. People don't like these houses. You can get this house with a cell phone exchange. You can get one house with your cell phone. Doesn't have to be iPhone. That doesn't have to be fancy. However, our research start to show that we are just beginning to do this research. The one thing that's missing in this area is scientific knowledge, the knowledge that can support the policy. But nevertheless, policy is made without knowledge. That's the situation. However, we realize that knowledge or information is never enough. So even with a little bit we know, we can try to influence the policies. So these are little we know, not answers, but questions we raised. The grassland appeared to be very diversified from place to place, given the microclimates and the topography. So it's highly spatially variable. And for a long time, grazing, the grazers and the grassland had established a coexistence, which that has had studies elsewhere. So here you can imagine, you can assume similar thing could happen here too. So ban grazing from livestock may cause negative consequences. For example, the grassland in this area is mostly alpine meadows composed of cobrizia, which is a shorter grass with a robust root system that formed the turf layer together with soil. With ban of grazing, in the past, it used to be a lot of wildlife grazing, but since thousands of years ago, human came in and wildlife largely reduced. So domestic grazers became the dominant population of grazers. And this grazing system has pretty much followed the wild herds, the routine of wild herds, which is largely rotating. So first household division of grassland has proved that caused problems, degradation, such as degradation elsewhere, elsewhere in North America, in Eastern Africa, and so on. We are monitoring now, doing the research to compare what smaller rotation, smaller area rotation cost. From just the common sense, you can imagine that larger, shorter grazing in a larger area would save much more grass than shorter rotation in the longer time, shorter rotation, smaller area rotation. But talking about the grazing ban, it's a different story. That with the ban, and wildlife would not come back immediately. So there is a period of time there aren't enough grazers. So what happens is that in addition to the fact that grazers, a lot of the grass, edible grass, had established response to grazers to increase the productivity after being grazed. That's a result from studies elsewhere. And in his area, after the grazing ban, what come first are the taller grass, which is the grass taller. The taller grass taking up most of the sunlight. As a result of that, the shorter grass, cobrizia, which is the main species that formed the alpine meadow, would not get enough nutrition from the sun. So the consequence could be shrinking of the root system. That is what degradation began. So the intention of this grazing ban might be good for grassland, but the result may not be necessarily good. So with that result, with that, also, the policy didn't consider people's willingness to protect the grassland, not to say the grassland is where what the livestock, the main livelihood of the local people dependent on. So the relationship, their relationship with grassland, you don't have to teach them. They know that. What has been changed over time is the policy on how you graze. So government tried to regulate how the grazing should be done. That actually broke the traditional nomadic system. That has been the problem. However, local people actually reacted to that with they agreed to divide up the grassland into households, but then they quickly formed the collective collaboration among households. And in some villages, they still rotate in a larger area because they immediately know smaller area would not be enough for livestock. So with that background, with that knowledge, you could immediately think of that management of grassland should be the responsibility of those households, and better to be a collective effort of households. So the top-down one-size-fits-all policy may not be appropriate, and households should be responsible for grassland management. So government should not worry about how the grassland could be protected, but the result of it. Well, to make this recommendation convincing, we have to prove it's working. First, it's usual that government would think that people don't know what to do. They always would like try to teach people what to do or regulate people what to do. So in our program, we try to convince the government that the communities can do conservation. They are not only willing to, but also able to, including some of the scientific monitoring to prove that things work by communities. One example is this village called Cuochi. The village there is large. One village can have thousands of square kilometers in size. And since 2006, we've been working with those villages to form a conservation unit, voluntary unit by villagers. So these are the achievements they have managed, including the management of grassland, seasonal ban of grazing, and some permanent ban of grazing that's left out for wild yaks. So with the authority, so what happened was the local government authorized the villagers to become the responsible for conservation. So they were given authorities. That was very much pressured by local people because this land is not only historical, ancestral land, but also their sacred lands. So conservation to local people is part of their cultural practice, religious ritual and cultural practice. And authorization of such rights becomes the most important incentive. After 6 years now, it's still working, and more villages, when they saw this village has achieved the result like that, would volunteer to come to ask for expansion of this program. And another research we have done is to really learn about how the culture and the biodiversity could are associated. This is one example that the culture, the villages with richer culture, traditional culture, has higher bird diversity. So with this background, this knowledge, not only the scientific knowledge, but also the cultural knowledge, we made the recommendation to establish a special zone for these headwaters of three rivers, the Yellow, the Yangtze, and Mekong, which is called Sanjiangyuan, means three headwaters, located in the east part of the Tibetan Plateau with a size of 400,000 square kilometers. And similar to Professor Bawa, I'd like to show you some of the features of this area. Different types of ecological services and culture as well, sacred lands and lakes. So we send the central government a petition to set up a special zone, which basically said conservation should be done by the local people. And as a result of the conservation, which provides so much values to downstream, and these people should be paid to do that as a service provider. So government should purchase their service. And the whole development in this area should follow the culture and the ecological norms. And last year, a special zone was set up as an ecological experimental zone to experiment. What is going to be experimented is the new policies. So here are some points that will be applied to in this area. One is that the payment for ecosystem service has been conceptually agreed by the central government, which will pay for nearly 20,000 jobs for local people to become conservationists, guides, people to do monitors. And these people will be organized into village in environmental councils. So all the decisions on grassland management, wildlife conservation, on the ground will be managed by a bottom-up effort set up in the villages. Well, again, these are specific recommendations we're trying to demonstrate on the ground right now to recommend to the government. Now the government approved the concept, but how to do it, how to organize communities, will still have to provide a standardized models so they can be replicated. And as NGO and academian, we provide scientific support, also the communication between stakeholders. And of course, government has a role to monitor and pay for such an effort. For example, government should not worry about how the process of conservation, but the result, like this one, through monitoring the result of grassland biomass changes, and you would know who is doing the better job, and the payment should be associated to these results. Like what Professor Pickett mentioned, that the world has changed, and the Himalayas changed, the Tibetan Plateau is changed. Population increased, and urbanization is happening with or without intention. So the world will never go back to its original forms. A new balance has to be established. So we're trying to describe how this new balance will look like. By the way, do you recognize, what is that shiny thing on the motorcycle? Do you know? Have you been to the plateau, anyone? What is that? You don't know? You know what it is? No? It's a boombox, loudspeaker, to play music so you have a motorcycle zoom by, and there was loud music, rock and roll, Tibetan rock and roll. So it's a matter of choice. So offer different options for different people. Some may move to town, but some would like to stay on with the land and manage the land. I think that's part of the solution. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask our panelists and commentators to come back up? And as they're doing that,